Shalom and welcome to this edition of Through the Lens. I'm Rabbi Eric Walker. When I came to the Lord, I had not been faithful in much, and God put it on my heart to be faithful in all things. His word is clear in this matter, and I was not going to be disobedient any longer. Like Paul said in Philippians 3:12, not that I have already obtained all this or have already been made perfect, but I press on to take hold of that for which Messiah Yeshua took hold of me. Here are some very compelling passages that emphasize God's call for us to be faithful. King Solomon wrote in Proverbs 2 and 6, "For the Lord God gives wisdom, and from his mouth come knowledge and understanding. He holds victory in store for the upright. He is a shield to those whose walk is blameless. For he guards the course of the just and protects the way of his faithful ones." He writes again in Proverbs 28:20, "A faithful man will be richly blessed, but one eager to get rich will not go unpunished." And Jesus said in Matthew 25:14, "Again, it will be like a man going on a journey who called his servants and entrusted his property to them. To one he gave 5 talents of money, to another 2 talents, and to another 1 talent, each according to his ability. Then he went on his journey. The man who had received the 5 talents went at once and put his money to work and gained 5 more. So also the one with the 2 talents gained 2 more. But the man who had received the 1 talent went off, dug a hole in the ground, and hid his master's money. After a long time, the master of those servants returned and settled accounts with them. The man who had received the 5 talents brought the other 5. "Master," he said, "you entrusted me with 5 talents. See, I have gained 5 more. His master replied, "Well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Come and share your master's happiness." The man with 2 talents also came. "Master," he said, "you entrusted me with 2 talents. See, I have gained 2 more. His master replied, "Well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Come and share your master's happiness." Then the man who had received the 1 talent came. "Master," he said, "I knew that you are a hard man, harvesting where you have not sown and gathering where you have not scattered seed. So I was afraid and went out and hid your talent in the ground. See, here is what belongs to you." His master replied, "You wicked, lazy servant. So you knew that I harvest where I have not sown and gather where I have not scattered seed. Well then, you should have put my money on deposit with the bankers, so that when I returned, I would have received it back with interest. Take the talent from him and give it to the one who has the 10 talents. For everyone who has will be given more, and he will have an abundance. Whoever does not have, even what he has, will be taken from him. And throw that worthless servant outside into the darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth." This is a clear call for us to be faithful with the little things. Then God will reward us with more because we've been proven trustworthy of what God has given to us. Jesus says in Luke 12:35-48, "Be dressed ready for service and keep your lamps burning, like men waiting for their master to return from a wedding banquet, so that when he comes and knocks, they can immediately open the door for him. It will be good for those servants whose master finds them watching them when he comes. I tell you the truth, he will dress himself to serve, will have them recline at the table, and will come and wait on them. It will be good for those servants whose master finds them ready, even if he comes in the second or third watch of the night. But understand this, if the owner of the house had known what hour the thief was coming, he would not have let his house be broken into. You also must be ready, because the Son of Man will come in an hour when you do not expect him." Peter asked, "Lord, are you teaching this parable to us or to everyone?" The Lord answered, "Who then is the faithful and wise manager, who the master puts in charge of his servants to give them their food allowance at the proper time? It will be good for that servant whom the master finds doing so when he returns. I tell you the truth, he will put him in charge of all his possessions. But suppose the servant says to himself, my master is taking a long time in coming. And he then begins to beat the men servants and maid servants and to eat and drink and get drunk. The master of that servant will come on a day when he does not expect him, and at an hour he is not aware of. He will cut him to pieces and assign him a place with the unbelievers. That servant who knows his master's will and does not get ready or does not do what his master wants will be beaten with many blows. But the one who does not know and does things deserving punishment will be beaten with a few blows. From everyone who has been given much, much will be demanded, and from the one who has been trusted with much, much will be asked. How much have we squandered of God's gifts to us? With so much sickness striking so close to home, are we taking the time to simply offer thanks for our help? Health. 1 Corinthians 4:2 says that for whom much has been given a trust, we must prove faithful. I want to share a story with you of one who proved faithful. There was once a bridge which spanned a large river. During most of the day, the bridge sat with its length running up and down the river parallel with the banks, allowing ships to pass through freely on both sides of the bridge. But at certain times each day, a train would come along and the bridge would be turned sideways across the river, allowing a train to cross it. A switchman sat in a small shack on one side of the river where he operated the controls to turn the bridge and lock it into place as the train crossed. One evening, as the switchman was waiting for the last train of the day to come, he looked off into the distance through the dimming twilight and caught sight of the train lights. He stepped to the control and waited until the train was within a prescribed distance when he was to turn the bridge. He turned the bridge into position, but to his horror, he found the locking control did not work. If the bridge was not securely in position, it would wobble back and forth at the ends when the train came onto it, causing the train to jump the track and go crashing into the river. This would be a passenger train with many people aboard. He left the bridge, turned across the river, and hurried across the bridge to the other side of the river, where there was a lever switch he could hold to operate the lock manually. He would have to hold the lever back firmly as the train crossed. He could hear the rumble of the train now, and he took hold of the lever and leaned backward to apply his weight to it, locking the bridge. He kept applying the pressure to keep the mechanism locked. Many lives depended on this man's strength. Then, coming across the bridge from the direction of his control shack, he heard a sound that made his blood run cold. "Daddy, where are you?" His 4-year-old son was crossing the bridge to look for him. His first impulse was to cry out to the child, "Run, run," but the train was too close. The tiny legs would never make it across the bridge in time. The man almost left his lever to run and snatch up his son and carry him to safety, but he realized that he could not get back to the lever. Either the people on the train or his little son must die. He took a moment to make his decision. The train sped safely and swiftly on its way, and no one aboard was even aware of the tiny broken body thrown mercilessly into the river by the onrushing train. Nor were they aware of the pitiful figure of the sobbing man still clinging tightly to the locking lever long after the train had passed. They did not see him walking home more slowly than he had ever walked to tell his wife how their son had brutally died. Now, if you comprehend the emotions which went through this man's heart, you can begin to understand the feelings of our Father in heaven when he sacrificed his son to bridge the gap between us and eternal life. Can there be any wonder that he caused the earth to tremble and the skies to darken when his son died? How does he feel when we speed along through life without giving a thought to what was done for us through Messiah Yeshua? In these challenging times, we cannot take this for granted. We're reminded of the words of King David in Psalm 139:23-24. "Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts, and see if there be any grievous ways in me, and lead me in the way everlasting." There is no question God is faithful. The real question is, are we? And that, my friends, is this edition of Through the Lens. Visit IgnitingANation.com for our guest lineup for our daily broadcast of Revealing the Truth, seen live Monday through Friday from 10 a.m. to 1 p.m. Central Time. Download our app, subscribe to our YouTube channel, and please consider supporting our ministry through the donate button on our website. Until we see you for the next edition of Revealing the Truth, we thank you for watching and bid you shalom.